meeting today. I pray that the Spirit of God rest with each of you this week as you faithfully try to do His will. Amen.
Amen.
Welcome to Kirtland. Seems more and more folks are coming to live in this part of the country. I was here with the first settlers, when there was nothing but forest for miles around, and the air itself seemed full of life. But the building of roads through this wilderness and the opening of the Erie Canal helped bring whole families this direction. In just a few short years, homes, towns, even churches have been built. You've got the Shakers, the Baptists, the Campbellites. This preacher here, Sidney Rigdon, he's one of the most popular rep. He's for the Campbellites. He's got churches all over these parts. Now, I'm not a religious man myself, but my good wife likes his sermons. Excuse me while I say hello. Morning, Sidney. Mr. Rigdon. Newell. What a crowd you have here tonight.
Mr. McCreary, what a pleasant surprise. Were you in our meeting this evening? I don't recall seeing you in the congregation.
Sidney, after all this year, you should know better. You won't catch Mr. Rigdon any longer than that.
And I've never known you to speak for less than two.
That's right. Sidney, the day you give a 30-minute sermon, I will be on your front row.
The Word of God will do you good, Christopher. I hope to see you in meeting one day soon.
Thank you kindly. My regards to Mrs. Rigdon. Newell, Mrs. Whitney. That's Sidney. He is a tornado in a top hat. He converts entire neighborhoods and then turns the men into preachers themselves. His churches have spread like wildfire. But the biggest religious wildfire, so to speak, is yet to come. That's the story I want to share with you tonight, the story of the Mormons. Now, I was never a Mormon myself, but I was here when their missionaries made their first converts in these parts, when they built that mighty church on the hill, the temple, they called it. But I am getting ahead of myself. Let's see, Newell and Elizabeth Ann Whitney. That's where I'll start this. The Whitneys were some of our finest preachers. They owned a store on the main crossroads, and they even ran the post office. Newell and Ann were members of Sidney's flock, but they weren't entirely convinced of the gospel, according to Mr. Rigdon.
It was 1830, if I recall
correctly. They both prayed to know the will of the Lord for themselves. They both had a vision, claiming that God's word was coming to Kirtland. Wouldn't you know, shortly after that, the first missionaries arrived in town.
Thank you.
young prophet, Joseph Smith, started bringing converts from New York and other parts together here in Kirtland.
Myself. parts. Be patient, child. More copies will come soon.
I don't think I can be patient. Sister Morley, please.
Oh, no, Mary.
Oh, all right. I guess I'll have to leave. Good day, Father Morley, Sister Morley.
Wait a minute. It is a business meeting tonight, and you probably won't even have a chance to read. If you promise to bring it back before breakfast tomorrow, you may take it.
Really? Oh, thank you, Father Morley. I'll have it back at first light tomorrow.
Mary, we got a letter from... But how?
Thank you.
another Book of Mormon of her very own. These Mormons loved their scriptures, and they loved learning. But they were here 1 year before Joseph Smith started organizing them into schools. My friend old James Ewells wrote me about it. Says the Mormons appear to be very eager to acquire education. They are by no means in the class men of weak minds. Men, women, and children likely attend school. They pursue their studies alone until 12 o'clock at night. Of course, they make rapid progress. I even recall they engaged a Hebrew teacher from the East Western Reserve College. These Mormons wanted to learn a bit about everything.
Woo-hoo! Woo-hoo!
All is well?
Well enough.
How's Phoebe?
Phoebe is managing our quarters quite well. Now she fits all seven children, three chickens and a dog, into our two small rooms. It's beyond my comfort.
I must say, I admire how the two of you have adjusted to living on the Lord's wages instead of a fancy preacher salary.
Poverty's called these days. Now I have news which is worth more than a preacher's life. As a Satius has arrived in person, he plans to attend me this afternoon.
We'll be learning Hebrew, Sydney, Hebrew! Soon we'll be reading the Bible in the original language.
Well, I'll have to tell the others. I want to make sure they all arrive promptly. Especially Hebrew. How he manages to be so late, he is right around the corner.
Don't mind Sydney. He's a bit excited at the moment. But how about you? You begin the children's school today, do you not?
I do.
Now, are you sure you want to teach them and the young women at the same time? I don't doubt your ability, Sister Snow. I only fear for your well-being.
My brother Lorenzo
would
very much like to attend.
Young Lorenzo, is he back from Auburn College?
Yes, I left him with a witness just now. But my students are expecting me. Would you please invite him to join you?
Of course.
Thank you, Brother Joseph. Oh, Brother Joseph, you will recall Lorenzo was not back here for the rest of our family. While he was in college, Dr. Logan would question the particular doctrine. I think he'll find his interest in more than just.
I look forward to having you in our class.
Thank you, Brother Joseph. Can you excuse me? The class will be impressed with me.
Brethren, welcome. As you have heard, we start an exciting new course of instruction.
instruction this afternoon. We also welcome a new student, Lorenzo Snow.
Oh, Lorenzo, welcome.
Glad you could join us here. This school of ours has benefited all of us in many ways, from improving Harley's penmanship to bettering my grammar. Of late, we have been studying the Holy Bible as part of our preparation for preaching the gospel. Today, we have studied Hebrew, so we may better understand the words of the ancient prophets. Professor Satius from the Western Reserve Academy will teach us. Sir, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Mr. Smith. Gentlemen, I am pleased to be here. Hebrew is a language of great complexity. You, the language of God, is chosen to be. Let us begin with the poetic account of creation.
What is Mr. Alexander Pope trying to express about the account gave properly?
Finer points of the New Testament in the city. You have fun. fine mind.
Thank you. In some ways, I feel as if I'm back at school with the other seminary students. But there it is all beginning a little. There are so many ways to interpret this in the Bible.
I noticed that myself as a young man.
Of course. First Bishop, I've heard you tell of it. I am in such a direct answer. I would have such an answer myself.
Regarding what?
Everything you teach, it's bold and powerful. Please don't misunderstand me. But heaven is patience, the Book of Mormon. How do I know this is really the Lord's work? You say the Spirit of God will manifest it. How? Have they shown me the sign? I really want to know.
Lorenzo, don't worry. Take it calmly. Ask the Lord, and He will show you the truth of this great latter-day work. And you will want to be baptized. Very well then. We'll see you at meetings tomorrow.
Yes.
I see your sister has come to fetch you. Until then, Brother Lorenzo.
He makes it seem so easy.
All that I've learned in my schooling just hasn't prepared me for this. Not the course I was pursuing, but I feel compelled. Thank you.
have to work alone again. My own work seems to get along, and I am pleased to hear company.
You are the only ones here? What happened to the men who were helping last week?
Oh, they found other work.
You're too polite to say other, Crosby, but I think you mean other work that can pay? These are difficult times for everyone, and yet you have stayed to help here. I can't tell you how grateful I am.
You and Joseph make plenty of sacrifice yourselves.
But you must take care of yourselves as well.
Carolyn, your hats are charming. But I imagine they don't quite stop yourself. I would like to give you this ham.
Oh, Sister Emma, thank you.
It smells delicious.
How are you for provisions?
Oh, we... Last night we... Oh, Carolyn, we have nothing left. Last night we had nothing. I knew we wouldn't starve in one night, but... And I'm mighty hungry this morning.
Yet you came here to work today. I am sorry that you don't know your situation.
We never thought.
I understand. It has never been easy for me to rely on the charity of others. And yet I've had to do exactly that many times. We do not have a house yet, but we do have food. Let me share it with you.
We're much obliged.
Why don't you stop by the Whitney store on your way home today? I have a stock of flour in your storeroom. Tell Anne I said to take as much as you can carry.
Well, thank you, Sister Emma. Thank you.
Even though they worked so hard, they still found time to come together to worship and study. Joseph seemed determined to make preachers out of every farmer and laborer among them. But they weren't just trying to convert their neighbors. No. They were preparing to preach to all the world.
Thank you, Brother Heber, for that fine testimony. That is the best way to preach the gospel, a short sermon with a prayerful heart. It is the way I hope each of you will preach in the months to come. The Lord has made it known to me that our period of preparation and learning has come to an end. It is his desire that the elders of the church serve a mission to the eastern United States.
I will go. I thought we were returning to school next month. Since I was baptized, I have felt my soul immersed in the Holy Ghost. The Lord has answered all my prayers, all my questions, my education to be. I want to proclaim the gospel. Who would you like us to leave?
You would leave your wife? She is...
Perhaps you haven't been in trouble yet. Harley, you don't even have at least a cover.
The Lord rarely asks his servants for any convenience. If we wait until it's easy to send the men away, how many of them will ever be?
I will go. As will I.
I'll go.
Sisters, I am as moved by your willingness to let your husbands leave as I am by their willingness to serve. For all of us, there will be hardships, even losses. We will be separated, but only for a season. And though apart, we will still be united by our faith. I promise that the Lord will bless and sustain you as we labor to build his kingdom. Jesus Christ lives, and this is his church.
Now, after the many testimonies which have been given of him, this is the testimony, last of all, which we give of him. we say to all the earth that he lives, lives, that he lives, that he lives, lives, and the Spirit whispering bears witness to our hearts that he
work.
Brother Bradley, pardon. Are you all right?
Yes. Just a little stunned. But the house was destroyed.
I'm so sorry. Thankful. I know it's not the same as having your own home, but please stay with me while the men are gone.
Oh, thank you, Amen. I'm taking care of you.
Pardon? About that debt you owe me. You seem to have enough problems on your hands. I'll forgive you, Amen.
I believe the Lord is making your duty increasingly clear. Now all we need is a coat and a hat for your journey.
Thank you all, and I thank the Lord.
Well,
other spirits and shared their labors. They cared for each other's sick as if they were their own. Why, I recall that one woman died in childbirth, Emma Smith, the doctor who grew newborn twins to raise as her burial. Emma Smith. Now, there was a woman who was at the center of it all. Emma and Joseph had more than their share of struggles, including the loss of one of those twins. When Joseph left to preach, she missed him sorely. But they were joined in the heart, and he wrote to her as often as he could. Why, my friend Will, the postmaster, once remarked that Joseph wrote to his wife more often than some husbands talk to their wives.
Thank you.
those Mormons played as hard as they worked. I'm not sure they ever rested. Once the men were back, they set themselves to building that magnificent church. The temple, they called it. To be like Solomon's temple of old. Glorious and grand. But it wasn't an easy prospect, even for such hard-working, hard-learned folk. At first, they didn't seem to know how to proceed.
Several months ago, the Lord commanded us to build a temple. We have not done it. The only thing we have decided upon is where to put it, on the top of the hill on Brother William's farm.
I offered my extra number, Joseph. Let's build a frame church, like that one I described to you, and like the one the Presbyterians had back in New York.
Oh, this is still the frontier, Heber. Out here we build log structures, plain and sturdy just like us.
We may yet have need of your lumber, Brother Heber, but not to build a frame building, or even a log one. We now have a better plan, given by the Lord himself, and you will soon see by this the difference between our calculations and his idea of things. We have rendered it here as best we can. Sydney?
Joseph, this is beautiful.
It is no wonder we cannot sell the details ourselves. We can never imagine such as this.
It will be a building the likes of which are not to be seen in this region. It will be 55 feet by 65 feet and 110 feet to the top of the tower. There will be a grand entrance hall with beautiful staircases.
But well, how are we going to pay for it?
It will require all we have and more to build this temple. The Lord will provide.
But who will lead the effort? There is no master builder amongst us.
I know the very man who did this work.
Who is he?
Artemis Milt. But he lives in Canada, and I do not think that he's hurt.
Brother Brigham, I give you a mission to go to Canada and baptize Brother Artemis Phyllis and bring him here to build our temple.
Of course, Brother Joseph. I'll leave right away.
Go, and Brigham, tell him to bring $1,000 with him when he comes. We have much to do before our builder arrives. There are trees to fell, and stone to quarry, and ground to break.
I will gather the tools. Shall I assemble a team of workers for next Saturday?
We have delayed long enough in obeying. I say when the Lord commands, do it. To the temple site, brethren, we have a field of grain below.